but it's fine, just indicate to us when you're relying on or referring to the court.
Okay.
First of all, can you tell us the difference between real and personal property?
Yes. Real property involves land. It involves the element of land. That's real property. Anything that is not land is personal property.
When is the, when, if ever, is a writing required for the transfer of deed?
The statute of frauds, which has been modified tremendously over the last few years, would require that in for real estate property transactions, you need a writing. On personal property, there are certain exceptions, but you may need a writing also on personal property as well.
Okay. In personal property transfer, is something through oral agreement?
Yes.
Can you tell us what an estate sale is in real estate records?
Generally speaking, when someone passes away, they either have a will or they don't have a will, in which case then their estate has to be administered. In either event, there are assets that are included in a decedent's estate. And those assets need to be transferred or dealt with in some fashion. They are either dealt with pursuant to the decedent's will, or they're dealt with pursuant to the statute of New Jersey or whatever state the deceased was domiciled in at the time of his or her death. So those rules will tell us to whom those assets are to apply and to go.
In a real estate transaction, in the absence of a discussion of the disposition of personal property, does personal property transfer in what's called an as-is transaction?
Well, I think you've asked two questions. The first question you've asked, the second question you asked is what is an as-is transaction? An as-is transaction deals with the property itself, not the personal property necessarily, unless it's specifically dealt with within the contract. For example, if I were to sell you a property and I was going to also sell you a water softener in that property, the question is whether or not the water softener works or doesn't work, or whether the softener is close to its the end of its useful life. So we would negotiate in that contract the sale of that water softener, and if I said I'm selling it to you as is, then it means if it breaks either before or after the day of closing, it's still your problem. It's not my problem as the seller. With regard to the real property, that's where as is generally is applied. It's applied in general legal cases and terms as to what is anticipated that the seller is giving to the buyer and what the buyer can expect. In the absence of any other language within the contract, if the contract says as is, it's what it says on its face. I'm receiving it exactly the way it is at the time that the sale occurs. So it's either at the time of contract or at the time of closing. And the reason I make that distinction is because a lot of times there are inspection contingencies in contracts that allow the buyer the opportunity to inspect things and determine exactly what the condition is. In the absence of anything else, if the contract says as is, the buyer receives it exactly the way it is at that time.
Did you review the contract for sale in this case?
I did.
Between Lisa Linder and
the Burke
entity that the Burks created for the...
Yes, I did.
What kind of contract was that?
That was pretty much a standard real estate contract. It does have provisions in it for the nature of the house or the property. As I understand it, this property had suffered years of neglect. It was rather full of material. and the purchaser was buying it for the purpose of rehabilitating it and reselling it. So the house was in pretty bad shape, as I understand the situation to be, based on the information that was given. The contract provided that it was being sold as is. The price on the contract, because I'm familiar with prices of properties, it seemed like it was a low price for a property in Asbury Park, but one could not tell. I couldn't make a determination on that. But it clearly specified that the property was being sold in the condition that it was in. There was nothing that was going to be done to it by the seller to make it any better than it was when the buyer first saw it. With regard to the personal property, on the other hand, that clause was left blank. There was nothing specifically included or excluded from the sale. It was left blank. And when it's left blank in that manner, it's not addressed at all.
Now, you were to assume that the testimony of both Lisa Linda and John Burke was to the effect that there had been no discussion of the disposition of the personal property prior to or had the contract of sale or even at the closing. Did personal property pass with the deed?
Generally speaking, whatever is left in the house is usually left without any indication of whether it's passing or not. It's just there. There's not a claim by the buyer that the property is the buyer's. There's not necessarily a claim that the seller, I forgot about it and I left it there. So it's generally not dealt with at all.
But then, does ownership pass with the deed in the absence of some discussion between the two as to who?
The deed does not pass ownership to personal property. The deed passes ownership only to the real property.
Now, I want you to assume that between 1939 and 1965, the property had been owned by either Lewis and Stell Abrams, or Stell Abrams, or Stell and Ann Abrams. And I want you to further assume that Stell and Lewis had a son, Irving. And I want you to additionally assume that at some point a safe is found in this house with business records of some sort, identifying the business records as Abrams and Son.
Okay.
And along with those other documentation, there is a box with a hidden chamber in which these 1882 gold certificates are secreted. And I want you to further assume that during the period 1933 through 1964, it was illegal to possess gold certificates. Are you able to make any assumption with regard to the ownership of those gold certificates, just with those facts?
With those facts, it would appear to me that if the certificates were contained within a container, whether it was a safe or whatever, that had other records of the Abrams family, that it was reasonable to assume that the certificates were also part of the Abrams family.
Now, if the title to the property passed from the Abrams to the owners to open the estate of Elaine Palmer, and it's safe, it didn't be in that same house. Was there any change in ownership of the certificates?
The certificates in these facts that you've just laid out were initially and conditionally and originally probably the Abrams certificates. They probably were their ownership because it was in their box with their other records and everything else. When you have an estate that passes assets, the assets generally, especially for personal property, depends on who is going to buy the property and what arrangements they've made for that. If there's no reference to that, then the ownership of those remain with the original owners of those properties. And I saw nothing in anything that you provided me that showed that someone knew that those certificates were there and intentionally passed those certificates on.
Now, can personal property be abandoned?
Absolutely. We actually have a statute in New Jersey. Statute is 4630C, and it deals with what happens if property is abandoned. The three words that are critical under the statute are lost, mislaid, or forgotten. And there's a provision in that statute that deals with the word finder, whoever the finder of that property might be. So there's a definition of finder which says whoever has possession of it is the finder. And if it's abandoned, lost, mislaid, or forgotten, and I'll strike the word abandoned, lost, mislaid, or forgotten, then it becomes the ownership of the finder. The finder is the owner of that property. And so in looking at this situation and reviewing it for you, I came to the conclusion that the finder of this property, Mr. Schaefer, was the owner of the property under 4630C.
Are retainer agreements required in real estate transactions?
Absolutely.
Exception for state sales?
No.
Now, assuming a other circumstances where the attorney can represent both parties in a real estate transaction, assuming that there is a waiver or conflict of interest.
Yes, there's a specific case in which the Supreme Court has indicated or drawn a fine line as to whether you can or can't. In complicated real estate transactions, you can't. It's a fine line. You cannot represent both parties. Up until the time of that case, you could, and lawyers found themselves in difficult circumstances. So the Supreme Court drew that fine line. When you have a simple real estate matter, it is possible to represent both parties, but then you need, under the present rules, you need a specific waiver of the parties knowing that there's potential conflict. And not only is there a specific waiver that you need, but the attorney has to reasonably believe that he can independently represent both parties without being in a conflict. The rules are 1.5 and 1.7.
All right, let's assume that to be the case. Attorney subsequently represent one attorney, one client in negotiations in a financial transaction with the other client?
It would depend upon the circumstances. Generally speaking, that's probably a conflict that is not waived.
Judge, that's essentially where I was going to the information.
Okay. Ms. Eisen?
Well, as I understand it, they were found in a safe that had other references to the Abrams businesses, to Irving Abrams business. They were in the junk business, and there were invoices and other certificates in that safe.
Well, suppose for the sake of argument that what's been testified to is that there were a bunch of canceled checks issued by Abrams himself. been negotiated. And will inevitably continue in this safe. Does what about that fact leads you to connect the ownership by the Abrams family of any other property that might have been found in that safe in another container or another part? Please tell us specifically what facts.
The mere fact that they are they're next to those types of
who told you they were next to?
Well, I understand that they were in the same vehicle. The
they
safe.
Were in a safe.
Right.
Do you have any information about when the checks issued by
see them?
Yeah.
Yes.
You saw them?
Yes.
The chapter?
No, I'm sorry. I did not see them. No, I Mr. Benedict advised me of them. I did not see them.
So Mr. Benedict told you that there were some checks that had been issued by an account apparently held in the name of Lewis Abrams.
Yes.
Other than that, what information do you have about those items in the safe?
The only thing would be the nexus of the those checks to wherever the other certificates were within the same year.
What information do you have about that nexus or that connection?
I think I just answered it. The nexus of those checks to where the certificates were.
Could you please be more specific?
I can't.
Well, are you assuming for the sake of this argument that they were put in there, that individual or individuals who placed the checks in this safe are the same individual or individuals who placed this other container in the safe? Is that your assumption?
Yes.
Do you have any factual information that remotely supports that?
No.
So you don't know when either collection of items went into that safe?
Correct.
You don't know when that safe came to the property?
Correct.
You don't know if there were any discussions between any members of the Abrams family and the Palmer family as to whether or not the safe was going to remain in the house once it was sold by the Abrams to the Palmer.
I do not.
So, in fact, there could have been an agreement. There could have been an arrangement by Mr. and Mrs. Palmer, who were purchasing the home from Anna Abrams, who would not, at that time was no longer living in the home. We see that there's a safe in the basement and we went to keep it. That could have happened, correct?
Well, the safe itself could have passed, yes.
Right. And so at some time other than the time or times that these checks were put into the safe, another container could have been put in the safe, moved from the safe, other items. You have no idea, correct?
I suppose that's true.
And in addition to that, it's not necessary to have a right, it's not necessary for a purchaser of property to take ownership, if you will, or legal possession, for lack of a better word, of personal property in the house. It's not necessary that it passes by way of the deed.
It doesn't pass by way of the deed unless the deed and the contract specifically provides for.
Right, and as you pointed out, you did analyze this contract to sale.
I did.
Okay, and you produced some more, I believe is actually now evidence, is S-103. And you said that the contract is signed with regard to that.
That is correct.
Okay, and specifically in paragraph 9, even though it's entitled personal property and fiction and fixtures, it speaks primarily of the passing of fixtures.
Right, and there's a reason for that.
Right, because obviously it's dangerous to start removing things that are structurally part of the property at the time that it passes without some discussion between the parties.
That's correct.
Because there can be all kinds But there's nothing preventing a buyer and a seller of property to make an arrangement amongst themselves, correct?
Correct.
And that happens all the time.
Yes, it does.
Okay. Now, in a situation where, even assuming, and I'm not conceding, but let's just assume for the sake of argument that there was not a formal discussion with regard to disposition of personal property left in the house, we are assuming that the house contained several items of personal property.
Okay.
Okay. And at the time the contract was signed, the contract is specified that it was going to be left in the room in this condition.
Yes.
Okay. And that's kind of a boilerplate provision that's in most standard real estate contracts.
I wouldn't say that. I would say that it's usually a negotiated item.
Okay. In this particular transaction, the language is in the contract, correct?
Yes.
Are you aware that at the time the contract was signed, are you aware that at the time that title passed, there was still a significant amount of personal property left in the home?
We're talking about which title passing?
We're talking about title passing from, I'm going to say, Lisa Linder in her capacity as the administrator of her grandmother's estate to Ed B. Creative Fireworks.
It's my understanding that there was a significant amount of matters within the property.
Okay. So that in fact it was not being left in poor condition?
True.
And there's nothing that you're aware of, there are any facts that this created an issue as between the buyer and the seller. Where the seller said, where the buyer said, seller, if you haven't performed under the contract, I'm not going through with this transaction because the house is still full of junk. To your knowledge, that didn't happen, correct?
I think it was sold as is.
That's right. So, as is, I mean, I know you said there is sort of the as is, which is term of art, which talks about we're not going to require inspection, we're not going to say you've got to have a termite inspection or a paint inspection. And that is sort of that's an as-is. That's one aspect of as-is, correct?
Correct.
However, there is also the physical reality that if the purchaser agrees at the time of closing to take possession of the property as it is, as opposed to in good clean condition, that's also a form of as is.
Yes.
So, whether or not the contract itself dealt with the transfer of personal property, as a practical matter, the property that remained in the house at the time of closing passed from the seller to the buyer. It didn't have to pass by way of the deed, but as a matter of behavior and interaction, as a practical matter, it did.
Yes.
Okay. You're not aware that there was any reservation of an ownership interest by either party?
The only thing I'm aware of is that Ms. Linder indicated to Mr. Schaefer that there was a Michael Jackson doll and there were some other personal things that she
right.
wanted to retain.
Right.
Otherwise, she told Mr. Schaefer to just get rid of the junk.
Right. But you're aware that at a certain point, she was no longer the owner of the property. She sold
yes.
it to somebody else.
Yes, she did.
And that person became the owner of the premises.
Or the entity that took
place. The entity became the owner of
yes.
the premises. Okay. And that was not Hugh Schaefer.
No.
The title of this property never passed to Hugh Schaefer.
Correct.
I want to come back to that, but I do want to go back very briefly to the idea of the retainer agreement. Again.
Excuse me. When I just answered that, I want to just clarify my last answer. You had said that Mr. Schaefer, the title did not pass to Mr. Schaefer. Ms. Linder said to Mr. Schaefer, as I understand the testimony, whatever is there is junk, just get rid of it. So in my way of thinking, Ms. Linder was telling Mr. Schaefer, just take it, do whatever you want to do with it, just get rid of it. The only thing she reserved were the specific items she told him she wanted him to have.
Right, but then she sold the house.
And she sold the house,
right.
Correct.
So, your opinion is that his ownership
to clean out the house. She was the owner of the house.
Correct.
And at that time is when she told him, get rid of the junk.
Right.
And that's when whatever interest she may have had in the junk would have passed to Mr. Schaefer.